Okay, so let's look at a comparison of the impulse and reaction turbines that we had derived expressions for in the previous lecture. First, let us compare the velocity diagram. Okay, right now it is smooth, symmetric, and maximum diagram efficiency is what we are trying to compare, because these are the expressions that we had actually tried to do. So what does the velocity diagram of the impulse turbine look like? VB, V1, VR1, VR2, V2. If you would recall that, the length of VR1 and VR2 would remain the same. The length of VR1 and VR2 would remain the same. Okay, it's just rotating this to get this. Okay. So this is the thing, like here angle here is beta 1, the angle here is alpha 1, the angle here is beta 2, and this is alpha 2, and in the case of maximum efficiency alpha 2 would be 90 degrees. Okay, so this is what we had seen, that this is what the velocity diagram looks like for this. In the impulse reaction, if this is your VB, this is V1, so VR1. So when V1 cos alpha 1 is equal to VB, the diagram efficiency is maximum, right? So that's how the diagram looks like this. So this is VR2 and V2. So you can see that VR2 is longer than VR1. So there is an expansion that happens through the rotor row. And so this is beta 1, now this is beta 2, and this is alpha 2. So again, alpha 2 is 90 degrees for maximum diagram efficiency. So this is something that we have seen. The main difference between these two diagrams is that VR1 and VR2 have the same length here. In the case of an impulse turbine, VR1 and VR2 are equal, and here VR2 should be greater than VR1. That is the main difference between these two. Otherwise, this is what the velocity diagram looks like. I have made it smaller because I have already made it larger in the last class. This is just for a comparison on the same table, so I am just making it smaller. Okay. Now, the diagram power is m dot VB into delta VW. Right. This is what we had derived. M dot into delta VW is the rate of change of momentum of the fluid, and VB is the velocity of the vane, and therefore M dot VB into delta VW is the diagram power, and that is the same here also. M dot VB into delta VW. There is no difference. Input power is m dot into V1 squared by 2. In the case of impulse turbine, it is only the kinetic energy of the incoming flow. Here it is m dot multiplied by V1 squared by 2 plus H1 minus H2, where H1 minus H2 is the enthalpy drop across the rotor. Okay. And this can be written in terms of the relative velocity change or relative kinetic energy change of the rotor. So it will be m dot into V1 squared by 2 plus VR2 squared by 2 minus VR1 squared by 2. right? This is what we showed yesterday. Actually, we didn't derive this, but you can derive it and check. If I apply the first law to the rotating row, I'll basically get H1 plus V1 squared by 2 is equal to H2 plus V2 squared by 2 plus the work output by m dot, right? So for the work output by m dot, if I substitute from this expression and then use the velocity diagram, I'll be able to simplify it to this. Okay, so I would like you to do it as an exercise so that you get that this expression is correct. Okay, so then the diagram efficiency is maximum when here VB by V1 is cos alpha 1 by 2, here it is VB by V1 is equal to cos alpha 1. Right? Basically says V1 cos alpha 1, which is the world component of the incoming velocity, is twice VB in this case. Here V1 cos alpha 1 equal to VB in this case. Okay, so that is what you see here. VB is equal to V1 cos alpha 1, and here VB is half of this V1 cos alpha 1. Okay. Then eta d max, the maximum diagram efficiency, here it comes out to cos squared alpha 1. And if I use this expression, cos alpha 1 is twice VB by V1. So this will be 4 times VB by V1 squared. That is the maximum diagram efficiency that you will get. In this case, it will be equal to again 2 cos squared alpha 1 divided by 1 plus cos squared alpha 1. This is something that we did not derive in yesterday's class, but we came close to deriving it. So I'll just show you the expression of yesterday's class. In yesterday's class, we derived this. VB by V1 is equal to cos alpha 1 corresponds to the maximum diagram efficiency. So if I substitute into the expression that we derived for the diagram efficiency, okay, in this, if I make VB by V1 equal to cos alpha 1, then this will be 2 cos alpha 1 minus cos alpha 1, which will be cos alpha 1 here, and this is 2 cos alpha 1, so 2 cos squared alpha 1 in the numerator. Denominator is, this is cos squared alpha 1 with a minus sign, and this is 2 cos alpha 1 into cos alpha 1 with a plus sign. So these add up to plus cos squared alpha 1. So that's the expression that we wrote just now. So eta d, when its maximum, becomes 2 cos squared alpha 1 divided by 1 plus cos squared alpha 1. This is your expression for maximum diagram efficiency. Correspondingly, if I look at the diagram power, divided by m dot, okay. So the diagram power, this expression, or the numerator of your diagram efficiency for eta d equal to cos squared alpha 1, or VB by V1 is equal to cos alpha 1 by 2 here and cos alpha 1 here. If I substitute that and simplify, what I will get is this will be equal to 2 VB squared, and here I will get VB squared. How do I get that? So for example, if I look at the diagram power here for the reaction turbine, m dot into VB into VW1 plus VW2, this VW1 plus VW2 we had written it as this, right? So here you substitute VB by V1 is cos alpha 1, then this will be, if I divide throughout by V1 squared and multiply by V1 squared, right. So, what I will get is VB by V1 here, and this V1 would get cancelled, this will be VB by V1. So, this will be the term that is there in the numerator that I will get. Okay, so, it will be m dot V1 squared into this, and this is something which we have already derived as 2 cos squared alpha 1, right. So, this will be m dot V1 squared into two cos squared alpha 1, and we know cos alpha 1 is V b by V 1. So, this will be m dot into V 1 squared into 2 V b squared by V 1 squared. So, V 1 squared gets cancelled, you get this 2 comes from somewhere else. So, this 2 is not there. Right, it's just VB. This 2 is coming from the denominator. So, it's this expression. So, this basically becomes m dot into VB square. Right, so that's the expression that I derived. So, per unit mass flow rate, you get VB squared as the diagram power, and here you get twice VB square. Okay. So, this is your comparison chart between impulse turbines and the impulse reaction turbines at their maximum efficiency point. So, you see that the expressions are very similar to each other except this one, which looks a little bit more complex as compared to this, but all the other expressions look quite similar to each other. And you see that if I have got a blade or a turbine running at blade velocity VB, this produces twice the amount of power for unit mass flow rate as compared to this, right. So, if you want to produce a certain amount of power with fewer stages of turbines, fewer rotors, then impulse turbine seems to give you a better option. Okay. But then if I have to use an impulse turbine, the velocity of flow that I have to use is higher, because if, let us say, I have VB as the blade velocity, the inlet circumferential component of the flow velocity should be V1 cos alpha 1, which is twice VB here. Okay. So, the flow velocity has to be much higher in the case of an impulse turbine, and that is the reason why it is able to produce more power per unit mass flow rate. Okay. So, that is the difference that you see, that an impulse turbine for a given stage and for a given rotational speed can produce twice the power as the reaction turbine. Okay. But efficiency wise, if I calculate for the same alpha 1, I will find this would be higher. Okay. So, now suppose somebody tells you that I would like to produce 100 kilowatts of power from a turbine, design one for me, right. The first question that you would ask is, how much money would you be able to put in, right. Is budget a constraint, or would you want a very economical or a work, you know, efficient turbine? Because this one efficiency wise is going to be poorer. If I calculate the cos squared alpha 1 and this and compare, I will find that this will be lower than this. Okay. When we also come to frictional losses, we will see that because this V1 is going to be much higher than this V1, because for the same blade velocity, this V1 has to be this long and this V1 has to be this short, right. So, the kinetic energy is proportional to the frictional losses. If I have more kinetic energy, there will be higher losses due to friction, and so on. So, in any case, the impulse turbine is going to have more losses and therefore lower efficiency as compared to the reaction turbine. So, the question that you would ask is whether you are going to invest a higher amount or a lower amount, because if I use one row of turbine, I would be able to produce 1 unit of power in the case of a reaction turbine, but 2 units of power in the case of an impulse turbine. Okay. So if I have to use the reaction turbine for the same power output, I'll need practically double the number of rows for the same blade speed. Okay. The other issue is the blade speed itself is r omega. So if the radius of the turbine is larger, for the same RPM, I would have a higher blade speed, and if the radius is smaller, I would have a lower blade speed. Okay. So these are the issues that come into your design calculations. So the radius, what would it then depend on? The kind of area that you would require for the flow to pass will be determined by the annulus area of your turbine blade. Okay. The blade height is your spacing of the annulus. So 2 pi r dr would be your flow area that's available to you. So depending on how much flow you need to put through, you'll make the passage this big or this big or this big. Right. So the radius is going to be determined by your mass flow rate for the same kind of velocity components. So these are the things that you would be typically looking at. So you would find that the impulse turbines are less efficient but more powerful. So with fewer stages, I'll be able to produce the required amount of power, whereas reaction turbines are less powerful and therefore you'll need a larger number of rows but will be more efficient. Okay. So these are the things that you would normally bear in mind. Even without going into very much detail of the understanding of the turbines, we are able to say this. Right. Now let's come to multi-stage turbines. Typically, we found that the power output goes as Vb square, right, in both the derivations that we saw for impulse turbine as well as the reaction turbine. A single row, the power output goes as Vb square multiplied by m dot, right. So for the impulse turbine, it will be twice Vb square, for the reaction turbine, it will be Vb square, but it goes as that. Now, what will be your limitation on Vb? The stress levels on your rotating blade at high temperature would determine how much can be a maximum blade velocity. I cannot have infinite blade velocity by using a large drum of the turbine, but the tip velocities of your rotating blades would be restricted by the amount of stress that is caused by the centrifugal forces on the blading. Okay. So if I have a blade like this and it rotates about a certain axis, the tip of it is going to have the largest centrifugal force, right. So the tip velocity is usually restricted by the strength of the blade at that temperature and how much centrifugal force it can handle. So usually when we are using ferrous materials for blades, steel alloys for blades, typical max Vb is about 420 meters per second. So you cannot have a blade running whose tip velocity far exceeds this quantity. Normally you would keep it under that. Okay. So your Vb, therefore, even if you keep it close to the stressing limit of this, cannot exceed this quantity. And as I told you, the radius of your turbine would go larger as the mass flow rate increases. So if you want to produce more power out of a given turbine, then you try to make it as large as it can be, but with this restriction. Okay. And your revolutions per minute of the turbine is usually governed by the frequency of your grid. So if you are producing 50 hertz, then your RPM has to be 3000 or multiples of that. And if you are producing 60 hertz, it would be 3600 or multiples of that, but you only have discrete values of your RPM. So omega cannot change too much, and the radius can only change within this limit for a given mass flow rate. So if you want to produce more power than that, and you want to increase the mass flow rate on the same turbine, then you will need to have multiple rows of turbines, each of which produces this kind of output, right. So, a single stage turbine therefore is not a realistic thing that one would go for, particularly with respect to power plants where you are investing a huge amount of capital. And if the, say for example, in a thermal power plant as on today, today's date, the investment per megawatt is of the order of 6 to 8 crores, okay. So, if you want to produce a 500 megawatt power plant, the typical investment in setting up such a power plant would be 500 multiplied by the number between 6 and 8, that varies with the market situation, the prices of items and so on. So, that is the kind of investment that you are putting in. So, for that kind of investment, when you put in, such an amount of investment and make a 100 megawatt power plant or 150 megawatt power plant, then you will need to replicate this kind of power plant in 150 places. You would rather put in a larger investment in the same place and make one unit which produces a larger output of power. This is typically something which economy of scale demands. People try to keep doing that. So, the unit output of power plants, the demand is going on increasing, okay. So, 20 years ago, the largest power plants that were set up were about 200 megawatts in size. That changed about 10 years ago. Everything that was invested upon was at least 500 megawatts each. Now, people are talking about larger power plants, people are talking about super thermal, ultra super thermal, super, you go for larger and larger capacities with single turbine, okay. So, why I am saying all this is, then you are actually trying to increase the mass flow rate through it. You are also trying to increase the inlet enthalpy of the steam by going for supercritical pressures, you know, pressures higher than critical pressure of water and so on. So, you are trying to get more out of one unit, okay. So, that all the more demands that with all these limitations in hand, and if you are increasing the enthalpy of steam at the inlet, this 420 might still further go down unless your material research improves the material, right. So, therefore, multiple stages of turbines is a must. You cannot just work with steam coming in, running one row of turbine and then going out. You will need to have multiple rows of turbines. The second thing that I talked about, particularly in steam turbines for example, the inlet enthalpy is in the range of 3400 kilojoules per kg. If you look at your steam tables for steam at the order of 180, 190 megawatts pressure and 540 degrees Celsius, the steam enthalpy goes to something like 3400 kilojoules per kg. And if you look at the steam saturated vapor at, let us say, 10 kilopascals or 5 kilopascals, which is where the normal exhaust of the turbine is, okay, that is at the pressure of the condenser, then your enthalpy you will see in the steam tables to be of the order of 2100 to 2200 kilojoules per kg. So, you have a range of about 1100, 1200 kilojoules per kg enthalpy drop. Okay. So, if I say delta H is equal to delta V squared by 2 for a nozzle, right, if I write the first law for a nozzle, then if the steam velocity is of this order, okay, 400 or let us say 500 meters per second, this 500 square will be 250,000 divided by 2, this will be 125,000 joules per kg or 125 kilojoules per kg. Okay, so, if I have steam at typically around this velocity or a little higher than that, the enthalpy drop that can typically happen in one stage of the turbine is of the order of 125,000 kilojoules per kg, 125 kilojoules per kg in the case of a reaction turbine and perhaps 250 in the case of an impulse turbine. Okay. So, still you cannot do with a single stage because you have about 1200 kilojoules per kg to drop. So, you will need multiple, right. So, either way, the multi-stage turbines is a must. You cannot just work with a single stage turbine in any case. So, in multi-stage turbines therefore, how do you stage the turbine And what kind of stages do you use? Do you use impulse stages? Do you use reaction stages? What are the issues with the various stages? Is something that we need to understand and then work with them. So first, let us try to understand multistage impulse. And then multistage reaction turbine. One of the obvious ways of doing it is that you get steam at a certain enthalpy and certain pressure into the stator of the first row, expand it, then take it through the rotor and the exhaust that comes out of the first rotor. This steam is at a certain pressure and a certain enthalpy. You can pass it through the nozzle to go to a lower enthalpy and then have another row. So you can have nozzles, rotors as usual until such time that the exit of the last nozzle is at a state beyond which you cannot further expand it. Okay. Say for example, you started steam at 180 bar. Okay. So the first expansion, let us say, has a pressure ratio of 3. So 180 to 60 bar, you expand it in the first nozzle. The second row, let us say it has an expansion ratio of 1.5. So from 60, you come down to 40. Then 40, again another 1.5, you would come down to something like 33 and so on. You keep reducing the pressure until such time that you come to the 0.05 bar or 0.1 bar, which is the exit pressure. So you have stages like that, right? So you can have a nozzle rotor, then again a nozzle rotor. So logically, one turbine put after the other. Okay. So this kind of compounding you can do for both impulse as well as reaction, right? So you have a nozzle row and a rotor row, that is one stage of the turbine. Then the steam that comes out of it, you pass through another nozzle and another rotor, another stage, another nozzle, another rotor, another stage, and so on. You can keep compounding that. This kind of compounding is called pressure compounding. Where you basically have nozzle, rotor, nozzle, rotor, nozzle, rotor, right? So this is your typical arrangement. This can be used both for impulse as well as reaction. There is another kind of compounding called the velocity compounding. Which is specific to impulse turbines. So what do you do in this? You have one bank of nozzles which accelerates it to a very, very high velocity. Okay. So the first rotor row is not able to absorb the entire kinetic energy. It absorbs a fraction of that kinetic energy. So the steam that comes out of the first row would still have a substantial velocity. Okay. So you don't have another nozzle row here, but you have a row that deflects it to the correct direction without any expansion or without any further acceleration and pass it through a second rotor row. Okay. You can similarly have 1, 2, 3 or even more than that rows with just one set of nozzles, depending on how much velocity the flow has been able to acquire in the nozzle and how many rotors will be required to absorb that kinetic energy completely. Okay. So it's like nozzle, rotor, deflector, rotor, deflector, rotor, and so on. Okay. So what is this then? Suppose I want to draw it here. This is your nozzle row. Okay. And you would have the rotor row which has reasonably symmetric impulse blading like that. Okay. So this is your rotor. So the flow that's coming out of it would have a velocity in this direction. Right, then you put a deflector which is also symmetric blading, so it doesn't accelerate the flow, it's just parallel kind of blading here. So but this is stationary, so this is stator, okay, so this row is stationary this row is rotating, this row is again stationary, and again you will have the next row of rotors. And so on. Okay, so the flow goes like this here, then turns around here, goes like this here, turns around here, goes like this here, turns around here, and so on. Okay, so this is your flow path, and that is what is done in a velocity component. So the difference between these two is that you have a single row of nozzles which accelerates the flow to very high velocity. Okay, and then it is extracted in multiple rows of rotors. So let us try to draw a typical velocity diagram of this kind of a rotor. This is velocity compounded or velocity compounding. Okay. So this is VB. Now as we understand, V1 is going to be very, very large. Okay. It is not going to be just as in the case of a single row turbine, V1 cos alpha 1 equal to VB or 2VB. That is not the case. Here you are going to have a V1 like this. Right. So it is a very high kinetic energy that has come in V1. So your VR1 would look something like this, and that if you rotate to this side, VR2, then you would have an absolute velocity V2. Okay, so this is your first rotor row. Okay, so the V1 was very high, and therefore the V2 does not have a zero circumferential component. It still has a large circumferential component. It has still a large magnitude of velocity. Now what do? I take this on the same blade or a blade with the same VB, because it is going to be at the same radius and usually connected to the same rotor. So the VB would be very similar if I am looking at the same radius. So the same VB, but now the V1 would be this V2, which is going to be turned around by a deflector to this magnitude. This will be, let us say, V1 prime, right. So this would be your VR1 prime, and this VR1 prime gets rotated here. VR2 prime and V2 prime. Now if this still has a large velocity and it can be absorbed further in a third row, you can have a third row with the same VB, but this deflected to V1 double prime. Okay, so you are looking at the third rotor now for the same kinetic energy. So then this will be your VR2, VR1 double prime, then that gets rotated here, and then you get V2 double prime. Okay. So finally, you would go until such time that your circumferential component is 0 or negligible. Okay. So that is what you typically do. So if you look at the turbine, you will have a row of nozzles here, and then you have a rotor blade. If I say this is your disc, this is the rotor blade. So this is fixed row, this can rotate. Then after that you have another row which is again fixed, and then you have, this is rotor 1, this is rotor 2, this is rotor 1, this is rotor 2, and this is rotor 3. Okay, so this rotor 2 is connected to the same shaft. Okay, and then you have another deflector row which is fixed, and you have another rotor 3. If you try to look at this. Each one of these is a disc. Each one of these is a disc on the same shaft. Okay. So if this rotates, all of these would rotate along with it. The rotor 1, rotor 2, rotor 3. Okay. And these things are fixed with the stationary casing of the turbine. So you have a outer casing of the turbine to which all these are fixed. So you have some separators so that the steam doesn't go from one compartment to the other. Right. So this is one stator, this is the other stator, this is the other stator. This has nozzles in it. And these two are deflectors D1 and D2, from which deflector D1 is the one that turns this V1 to this V2 to V1 prime, and the deflector D2 is the one that turns this V2 prime to V1 double prime. Okay. So the flow comes in here at V0, comes out here V1 to the first rotor, comes out here at V2, goes in here at V1 prime, comes out here at V2 prime, and goes in here at V1 double prime, and goes out here at V2 double prime. Are you able to visualize this? This, you are going to have three wheels of turbine, one after the other, separated by the nozzle row here first, deflector row here. If you look at the blade rows, you will have nozzles which look like this. Then you have the first rotor row, then you have the deflector row, then you have the second rotor row, second deflector row, and so on. Okay, in the meridional plane, this is rotor 1 and this is rotor 2, this is deflector 1, this is deflector 2, and so on. Are you able to understand what exactly I am drawing? If you are not able to understand what you are drawing, just ask. What I am showing here is a meridional plane, which is at some radius you cut, okay, and expand the strip wholly. Each one of these is a circle, right? If I draw this radius, at this radius, it's a cylinder. You cut it open and open it out. Then you'll first see the nozzle here. Okay. Then you'll see the first rotor row. Then you'll see the second, the deflector one. Then you'll see the second rotor. Then you'll see the next deflector, and so on. Is that clear? So I'm just drawing this on the meridional plane, and this is an elevation from the front. This is your shaft. So you'll have the same thing on this side also. Okay. So the same radius. So it's a cylindrical system, right? So this annulus is where the steam flows, and these are the discs through which nothing can flow. Okay, you have the disc and you have a blade arrangement around that thing there. Okay, so velocity compounding basically is where you have one row of nozzles and then multiple rotors extracting the same kinetic energy in steps. Okay, whereas in the case of pressure compounding, you'll have the same kind of velocity diagrams as you had for the first row in the second, third, fourth rows. Whereas here the velocity diagrams are different and the angles will also be different. Your alpha 1, beta 1, here and here and here, they are all going to be very different because your velocity diagram has changed, the velocity lengths are shrinking, so the angles have to change. Okay. So here you will have a very small alpha 1 and beta 1. Here the alpha 1, beta 1 will be larger than that. Here it will be even larger because the diagram is shrinking in the lengthwise direction. Is that clear? But the component which is in the axial direction would not change from here to here. So the axial component will remain the same here, here, here. So the diagram will get actually compressed and you will get the angles changing there. Okay. So this is the difference between a pressure and velocity compounder. So this velocity compounder triangle, this one, you can understand that you are using a single row of nozzle to get a very high velocity. Why would you do that? Because very high velocities, we know that, are liable to cause more kinetic energy losses because of friction. Then why would we do that? The reason for that is that I am trying to show you some things here. See, the pressure here of the steam will be very high, and after this nozzle the pressure will be very low. Okay. And there are going to be gaps here in between the stator and the rotor. Will have some gap because this has to rotate, it cannot be in contact with the body or the casing. So there is going to be a gap here. So because the pressure here is very high and the pressure here is small, the amount of leakage that can happen across one nozzle row is going to be a problematic thing, and that will be very severe when the pressure is very high. Let us say the pressure is 200 bar and the nozzle pressure ratio is 3, so the other side pressure is 60 bar. From 200 bar to 60 bar, there is a 140 bar pressure drop, and that can cause a huge amount of leakage, and number one. Number two is, at 200 bar, the density is very high, so a small volume of leakage would mean a large mass of leakage, right. So the quantity of leakage, even if the volume of the leakage is very small, in terms of the percentage of mass of steam that has leaked, that will become a large quantity. So at the high pressure end of the turbine, one would like to reduce the pressure as quickly as one can, and so one tries to go for the velocity compounded impulse turbines. So this kind of a turbine is normally used at the first stage of the high pressure turbine, what we call the HP turbine of a steam power plant, the high pressure turbine. The first stage turbine usually uses this, so that the pressure is suddenly decreased from, let us say, 180 or 200 bar to about 50-60 bar, and after that you use smaller pressure ratios and smaller this one, because already the pressure has decreased threefold, so the density has gone up, density has gone down threefold, so the severity of your leakage losses would reduce, and after that you can use the other kind of turbines. So this, in spite of the fact that its efficiency is poorer, in order to minimize leakage, one goes for this kind of a turbine at the highest pressure end of a steam turbine. Is it clear? So that is the reason why this kind of a turbine is used. Otherwise, velocity compounded turbine is not commonly used elsewhere. It is commonly used only at the high pressure end of a steam turbine. So that is about multi-stage turbines. Then we can discuss a few other issues. One is the blade height. So as I already told you once, if I look at the three-dimensional view of a typical turbine, this is your turbine disk on a shaft, and you will have turbine blades mounted on it like that. Right? Like this. Now, the flow area that is available to the steam or the working fluid is this annulus. Okay. So if I have steam flowing from here, it actually flows. If I draw the front view of this, this is your turbine disk and these are your blades. So this is your outer casing, this is how your blades are. So the area that is available for the steam to flow is perpendicular to this, which is this annulus. Okay. So if the mean radius of this is a certain r, then the flow area would be equal to 2 pi r into, if this is the height of the blade h, 2 pi r into h would be the actual flow area available for the steam to go, or any working fluid to go, isn't it? Because it is an actual flow turbine, you have a steam turbine row here, the steam comes in from here and goes out to the other side, the area that is available to it is the annulus that it can see. Okay. So if I neglect the thickness of all these blades, then the flow area that is available to me is 2 pi r into h, that is neglecting blade thickness. right? So this is something that we need to clearly remember, that the height of the blade automatically determines the flow area that's available. Okay, and depending on how much steam we need to admit in one stage, or how much enthalpy drop we are planning in one stage, we will need to decide on the size of this annulus. Okay, so the height of the blade is correspondingly decided, the size of the disc and the height of the blade. In the case of a steam turbine, for example, at the high pressure end, the pressure is typically close to 200 atmospheres. Okay, in supercritical turbines, it's even higher than 300 atmospheres. But in most other power plants, where the pressures are less than critical pressure, the critical pressure of steam is 220 atmospheres. So if the pressure is lower than that, you keep the steam at the inlet of the turbine to be around 200 bar or 180 bar, 190 bar. Typically, that's the kind of pressure. So at that pressure, the density is quite large, and therefore the mass flow rate of steam can actually flow through a smaller area. Okay. If you go to the lower end of the same turbine, the pressure that you are looking at is 1/20th to 1/10th of an atmosphere. Okay. So if you compare it with the inlet pressure, the pressure ratios are of the order of 2000. Okay. 200 bar here and 0.1 bar here. So the pressure ratio is about 2000. Even if I don't worry about anything else and say, okay, let steam behave very similar to an ideal gas, for this pressure ratio, the density ratio would be of the order of 2000. Right. So for the same mass flow rate to flow, the area requirement would increase typically about 2000 times. You understand? The steam that has entered the turbine has to leave it. Okay, it enters at 200 atmospheres and leaves the turbine at 0.1 atmospheres, then the volume it would occupy is about 2000 times the inlet when it comes to the outlet. So it gradually increases from a very small mass, a very small volume, to a very large volume for the same steam to pass through. So what happens is that at the highest pressure end of the turbine, the area required is very small. Okay, so you also keep the radius small, and you also keep the blade height small, so that the annulus is very small. But as the flow goes downstream, you will also need to increase the radius, and you will also need to increase the blade height. So if I can give you a few typical size figures, the first stage of a turbine, let us say 200 kilowatt, 200 megawatt turbine, the first stage of the turbine has blade heights like this, something like 1 inch, okay, 2.5 centimeters, 2 centimeters kind of height. That's the blade height that you would find in the first stage with a drum size something like this, right, about 15, 20 centimeters drum height, drum diameter and blade height like this. The same steam which actually flows through a 20 centimeter inner radius and about 2.5 centimeter blade height annulus would require a drum size of about 3/4 to 1 meter and a blade length of about 1.5 meters at the exit end. Right? That's the kind of area increase that is required. So the blade actually, the turbine actually starts at this size and then expands to an exit diameter where the drum itself is about this and you have blades which are 1.5 and 1.5, so almost a 4 meter diameter size turbine. So the turbine starts at about this size and ends up at about 4 meter diameter. So that's the size of expansion that happens. So your turbine, if you want to show it like this, it's something like this. So you'll have the drum that goes like this and the blade heights that go like that. So at the inlet, this is about 2 centimeters. And at the outlet, this is about 1 to 1.5 meters. Okay, and here it's about 20 centimeters, and here it's about around 1 meter. So this is how typically a turbine goes. And this is not all. What is usually done is that the high pressure turbine is a single unit, but in the intermediate or the low pressure turbines, you divide the steam into two parts. and allow it to flow through two separate turbines. So you have one turbine which expands like this and another turbine which expands like this. So the steam, half of the steam goes here and half of the steam goes here. Okay, so that this area increase is not made so unwieldy, but can be made slightly less. So your turbine diameter, instead of going to 4 meters or 4.5 meters, can be at around 2 to 2.5 meters. Okay, and 2 to 2.5 meters is still as big as, probably most of us are bigger than that. My height is 167 centimeters, right? So we are looking at something like 2.5 meters, which is that much. So that's the kind of size that you typically end up with a turbine with. Starting size of this work, that's typically the thing. So blade height, therefore, is a very interesting or important thing. If it is this big, okay, it doesn't look to be a very tall blade, but if the blade itself is this big, then it is large, right? So, and if you are looking at tip speeds restricted to 400, 420 meters per second, then accordingly the size restriction and all the other things come into place, right? So with a small turbine, you won't really feel what will be the kind of speeds that it is running at. But when the blade itself is tall and it's running on a big drum, the tip speeds can be substantially high and you can feel that. Right? So that's the. So this is about blade height, and the blade height directly is related to your mass flow rate and the specific volume at that location. If the specific volume is large, that when the pressure is lower, the specific volume is large, then the blade heights need to be longer. In other words, they need to be shorter. Okay, so this is one thing. The other thing is that blade speed is R omega, where R is the radius at which you are looking at the speed. So if you have a turbine disc like this and a blade like this, and you are looking at a certain radius R here, and this is rotating at omega, the blade speed would be R omega, right? But the R is different here and different here. The radius at the hub of the blade is different from the radius at the tip of the blade, and if the blade is this small, the difference is not too much different, the radius is not too much different. But if it is a blade of this size, with about 1 meter radius at the center and 2.5 meter radius at the periphery, then the radius changes substantially and therefore blade speed changes also substantial. If I draw a velocity diagram saying that this is VB, this is V1 and this is VR1, the question that comes is, where is this VB? Is it at the root of the blade? Is it at the middle of the blade? Is it at the tip of the blade? Where is it? If I say, okay, this is at the middle of the blade, then how will be the variation between the root and the tip? So then your VB at the root of the blade can be like this, middle of the blade can be like this, and the tip of the blade can be like this. So this is VBR, VBM and VBT. Because I have a drum on which the blade is mounted, this is the radius at R, this is at RM, and this is at RT. Okay. Right. So the radii are substantially different, and therefore the R omega values, the VB can be substantially different. And therefore, for the same V1, the beta 1 here, the beta 1 here and the beta 1 here can be completely different, right? So we need to make arrangements in such a way that, number one, the flow enters tangentially on the rotor blade at all radii, right? That's something which is necessary, because without which we'll have recirculation losses, because the flow would not go smoothly and tangentially to the blade, right? So that's an important thing to happen. And if that has to happen, either you need to vary V1 or you need to vary beta 1 or you need to vary both. Okay. Similarly, at the exit, if I would require the angle to be 90, right. Now, you look at the way the different velocity triangles are. If the blade turns, okay, from here to here, this angle has to be different at different radii because of the different inlet angles that are there. And therefore, what is typically done to take care of the variation with the length is that the blade usually gets twisted along its length. So, you do not keep the blade straight like this, but you twist the blade. Okay. So, this beta goes on increasing from here to here, root to the tip. Okay. This is beta 1 root, beta 1 middle, beta 1 tip. I have shown a very extreme case. Okay. So, let us say if this is V 1, this is 1, this is the second and this is the third. This is the three values of beta 1 at the root, middle and tip. So, this is beta at the root, beta at the middle and beta at the tip. You see that as I go from the root to the tip, the beta value goes on increasing, okay, which basically means that this angle should go on increasing. The entry angle of the vane should go on increasing from the root to the tip. So, I need to twist the blade, right. So, that is one part, and the second part is at the exit, if I want to keep the relative velocity, absolute velocity normal to the plane of the turbine, then again I will need to adjust the exit beta such that this happens. Okay. So, you vary both the shape of the blade and the twist of the blade from the root to the tip. So, you do not have the same aerofoil running from the root to the tip in the most complex situation, particularly when the blades are very long. Okay, when the blades are very long, what I told you as extrusion of one die and then just putting it in every this one, that will not materialize because you will need different aerofoil shapes at different sections of the blade, and it also needs to be kept in a twisted shape. So, the manufacturing of the blade itself becomes a big challenge. It has to be designed appropriately for all radii and manufactured correctly. But for shorter blades, what I told you can work, particularly for gas turbine blades which are never too long. What I told you would work beautifully. Okay. So, this is another thing that we need to understand, that because of the three dimensionality of the turbine itself, we only looked at the axial direction and the circumferential direction earlier. Now, if you also look at the radial direction, the VB itself varies with R linearly, and therefore, your velocity diagram keeps changing from one location to the other, one radius to the other. And so, the three dimensionality of the velocity diagram needs to be borne in mind while designing the turbine correctly, right. So, we will stop at this point. We will conclude the discussion on these things in the next class.